you're dealing with a group of people in the Reagan administration who equated political dissent with treason and who cannot differentiate between emergency procedures, which I think everyone agrees are necessary, and suppressing political dissent. And with North and Poindexter and Casey, you had a group of people who saw Americans who disagree with them as the enemy.
Colonel North, in your work at the NSC, were you not assigned at one time to work on plans for the continuity of government in the event of a major disaster?
Mr. Chairman.
I believe the question touches upon a highly sensitive and classified area, so may I request that you not touch upon that, sir?
I was particularly concerned, Mr. Chairman, because I read in Miami papers and several others that there had been a plan developed by that same agency, a contingency plan in the event of emergency that would suspend the American Constitution. And I was deeply concerned about it and wondered if that was the area in which he had worked. I believe
I most respectfully request that that matter not be touched upon at this stage. If we wish to get into this, I'm certain arrangements can be made for an executive session.
And tragically, the only member who got close was Jack Brooks, and he was stopped by the chairman. But the truth of the matter is that, yes, you do have those standby provisions, and the plans are there, and the statutory emergency plans are there, whereby you could, in the name of stopping terrorism, apprehend, invoke the military, and arrest Americans and hold them in detention camps.
If the president ordered a direct strike into Central America, which was to be codenamed Operation Night Train, we've got the documents on it, that they would set up a concomitant domestic readiness exercise or war game scenario called Rex 84, the main rationale of which was to round up 400,000 undocumented Central American aliens within a two-week period of time and incarcerate them in 10 military detention camps.
They rehearsed this, but of course, if you were rehearsing the rounding up of 500,000 aliens, you have also rehearsed the rounding up of 500,000 critics of the administration. It would be very, very wrong to think that these kind of illegal operations will stop just by Ollie North's disappearing, because the motives to generate these kind of agendas are still there. And the powers that were collected in his name, his office, as far as I know, they are still there.
In times of passion and in times of great fear, what to the eyes of the person and the mind of a person in time of relative peace and stability seem impossible, become very real, very logical, very possible.
It was originally billed as an umbrella organization to administer emergency relief in the event of a natural disaster or a national crisis. But its true purpose lies in carrying out a series of executive orders if the president declares a national emergency, which has never been defined. Executive Order 10995 provides for seizure of all communications media in the United States. 10997 provides for seizure of all electric power, fuels, and minerals, both public and private. 10998 provides for seizure of all food supplies and resources, public and private, all farms and farm equipment. 10999 provides for seizure of all means of transportation, including personal cars, trucks, or vehicles of any kind, and Executive Order 11,000 provides for seizure of all American people for workforces under federal supervision, including splitting up of families if the government has to. And Executive Order 11051 provides the Office of Emergency Planning complete authorization to put the above orders into effect in times of increased international tension or economic or financial crisis. Get the picture? Any national banking or currency collapse could put FEMA into action as a national police force under martial law conditions. The same groups who helped devise FEMA have created a global movement to centralize economic power in various puppet organizations that preach peace and stability through some variation of socialism, but act aggressively to draw nations into a web of foreign debt and servitude to their own agendas. The United Nations, the World Bank, the International Monetary Fund, the Trilateral Commission, Bilderbergers, and the Council on Foreign Relations are all committed to agendas of world domination through manipulation and monopoly of economic power.
Basically, anarchism, what it means is that the belief that we need to reduce to the greatest extent possible all hierarchies of power, control, and status.
Anarchism is a society based on mutual aid, self-sufficiency, non-hierarchy.
So in the political arena, we want more democracy, not less. We want direct democracy, not representative democracy.
More well-known anarchist figures are people like Mikhail Bakunin,
Peter Kropotkin,
Emma Goldman, Malatesta, etc.
Or, you know, recently, more recently, people like Noam Chomsky or
Howard Zinn.
You don't need to have ever read any of these people or heard of any of these people to be an anarchist and to be a damn good anarchist. You don't have to ever have heard of any of these people.
I think the most common misconception about anarchists is that they're violent.
That they're all punks.
That everyone is a white middle class violent anarchist who has nothing else on their mind except to destroy property.
Self-proclaimed anarchists with nothing but destruction on their minds.
But what I think is really interesting about the current movement is that it's using these concepts of consensus decision making and using these concepts of affinity groups.
But the affinity groups are autonomous. There's no leader that's saying, okay, you, this affinity group A, you do this, affinity group B, you do that. The affinity groups themselves decide what they're going to do. And that comes straight out of the Spanish Civil War.
And the Iberian Anarchist Federation had 15,000 people who were all self-organized into these grupo de afinidades, or affinity groups. And they got together on a local, a regional, and a national level to plan how they would transform Spanish society into a free society.
Anarchism right now, is, in my view, its most important goal is to make connections across class and race lines and to build bridges, to build solidarity, to build a communications network that allows people to have these voices represented.
If we're serious about standing up to the system, it's our job to make those ideas clear, not dress them in subcultural language, but to actually say, these are basic common sense ideas. Regular people should run our lives, not corporations. We should do it based on what's good for our community and for the environment, not based on centralizing power and wealth. And if we can stand up to the efforts to marginalize us, and often using the word anarchism or images of anarchism, and get to the point and be very clear, then I think we can and will be able to apply those principles, stand up to the system, topple it, and build a new world in its place.
Historically, have there been any sustained examples on any substantial scale of societies which approximated to the anarchist ideal?
There are small societies, small in number, that have, I think, done so quite well, and there are a few examples of large-scale libertarian revolutions which were largely anarchist in their structure. As to the first, small societies extending over a long period, I myself think the most dramatic example is perhaps the Israeli kibbutzim, which for a long period, may or may not be true today, really were constructed on anarchist principles, that is, of direct worker control, integration of agriculture, industry, service, personal life on an egalitarian basis, with direct and, in fact, quite active participation in self-management, and were, I should think, extraordinarily successful. A good example of a really large-scale anarchist revolution, or largely anarchist revolution, in fact, the best example, to my knowledge, is the Spanish Revolution in 1936. And in fact, you can't tell what would have happened. That anarchist revolution was simply destroyed by force, but during the period in which it was alive, I think it was inspiring testimony to the ability of poor working people to organize, manage their affairs extremely successfully without coercion and control.
How far does the success of libertarian socialism or anarchism as a way of life really depend on a fundamental change in the nature of man, both in his motivation, his altruism, and also in his knowledge and sophistication?
I think it not only depends on it, but in fact, the whole purpose of libertarian socialism is that it will contribute to it. It will contribute to a spiritual transformation, precisely that kind of great transformation in the way humans conceive of themselves and their ability to act, to decide, to create, to produce, to inquire, precisely that spiritual transformation that social thinkers from the left Marxist tradition, from Luxembourg, say, on over through anarcho-syndicalists have always emphasized. So on the one hand, it requires that spiritual transformation. On the other hand, its purpose is to create institutions which will contribute to that transformation.
Centuries in the West, Jerusalem has been the symbol of the ideal city.